This notice was printed in a church bulletin, not ours, in a church bulletin. The pastor announces that if we reach our fundraising goal, he will allow a clock to be installed in the pulpit. If we exceed the goal by $2,000, he will allow it to be plugged in. If the offerings exceed the goal by over $2,000, the pastor promises he will look at the clock. So that's pretty good. Then you think you're having trouble with people you do business with. This company was advertising a carburetor device to save gasoline. The last line read, "If not satisfactory, money will be returned." When the product didn't work and customers complained, they got back a form letter that said, "So far, all the money we have received has been satisfactory." That's what it said. If not satisfactory, money will be returned. So, all right, Galatians chapter number 3. Galatians chapter number 3. We are moving out, aren't we? Galatians chapter 3. Before we begin in verse 1, I want you to see something about this chapter. It certainly give you some idea of what the discussion will be throughout. Verse number 2, look at the last word of the verse, faith. Verse 5, last word of the verse, faith. Verse 7, faith. Verse 8, faith. Verse 9, faith, faithful. Verse 11, last word, faith. Verse 12, faith. Verse 14, last word, faith. Verse 22, faith. 23, faith. Faith again. 24, faith. 25, faith. 26, faith. 15 times. In one chapter, faith, faith, faith. We walk not by sight, walk by faith. Want a way to a heaven we haven't seen, saved by blood we haven't seen, through the grace of a Savior we haven't seen. We don't walk by the sight of our eyes. How many, many times every single day men are deceived by the sight of their eyes.
Right.
We walk by the certainty of faith. People say, "Well, you know, if I could see it, I'd believe it." You can't believe everything you see. If you could believe it, you could believe it. That's what the Lord wants. He wants us to walk by faith and not by sight. Now, Scripture says here, starting in verse number 1, "O foolish Galatians." So that's not a very nice thing to say. It's not nice if it's not true. If it's true, words mean something. If this word defines the condition of the people in the churches at Galatia, then it's the only word you can use. "Oh, foolish Galatians," why would he call them that? "Who hath bewitched you, that ye should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you? This only would I learn of you. Received ye the Spirit by the works of the law, or by the hearing of faith? Are ye so foolish, having begun in the Spirit? Are ye now made perfect by the flesh? Have ye suffered so many things in vain, if it be yet in vain?" Father in heaven, help me to make the truth of these matters as clear as I possibly can. Lord, may those that are here this morning be found willing to walk in the light. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now again, there is an assumption made when the Holy Spirit through Paul writes to the churches of Galatia. Just as there is an assumption made when the preacher stands on a Sunday morning to speak to the congregation, there is an assumption made that people want to do what's right. There's an assumption made that people want to be what God wants them to be. The Scripture here is arguing with, contending with, pleading with people who have believed on Jesus Christ. But after their initial belief in Jesus Christ, they have grown disinterested. they have decided they don't want to go on to that perfection, that complete working of God in their life. And so the Holy Spirit refers to them as fools who have been bewitched. Not because they haven't called on Jesus for salvation, but because, as we saw last Sunday morning, they don't want anything more than that. Someone once deceived us into thinking we didn't need Jesus in order to go to heaven. The Holy Spirit broke through that deceit and that deception. Our eyes were opened and our hearts we saw and believed that I do need Jesus to get to heaven. And then that deception and that blindness sets in once again and convinces us that we don't need Jesus in the meantime. And the Holy Spirit starts to plead all over again, starts to appeal all over again, starts to try and convict all over again to convince us that not only do we need Jesus to get us to heaven, we need Jesus to get us through the hour by hour experience of life here on earth. Amen. And he refers to a lost man who thinks he can get to heaven without Jesus. The Bible refers to them as fools. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Well, the same term is used for people who have been saved, who now think they can get through this week or this month or this year without faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. It's folly. I admit there's a God to get me to heaven. But I live as though there's no God to get me through child raising. There's no God to get me through my marriage relationship. There's no God to get me through the temptations that I face on a day-to-day basis. I am living practically like an atheist. I believe there's a God up there for when I get up there. But I don't believe there's a God for down here while I'm living down here. Now, we wouldn't say it that way. But how often do we live that way? And that's what's being addressed here. Now, let me set forth another assumption that is made by the Holy Spirit through the Bible writers, by the preacher who preaches the Bible. Here's another assumption that is made. That you're interested in putting into practice the truths of the Holy Bible. Not just learning them. Now, I understand. I'm gonna try to not sound like a crazy man, but make the point. I understand there are people with a desire to learn truth about God who attend a church like this one because I'm not going to read half a verse and then rant and rave about my opinions. I'm not going to take a verse out of context and then threaten your children with death if you don't give money. You are here because you want to learn something about the Bible and you have found that in this place you can learn something about the Bible. Okay, that's fine. I understand that. However, I don't understand anybody going to a golf camp and not wanting to then play golf. I don't understand anyone going to a music school and then going home to a house with no instruments and having no desire to play a musical instrument. I don't understand someone enrolling in a tech school and spending 3 or 4 years to learn a trade and then never even applying for a job. And so, and I'm not being critical, glad you're here, come every time you will, but there is a certain assumption made that you're not going to just learn about Christianity, but that you are going to want to leave from here and go put it into practice. And many people have and will continue to spend months or years or more in our church who will then leave our church having no disagreement with any of the doctrines that we teach, but who have just grown weary with the constant reminder that Once we finish the golf clinic, you ought to play 9 holes.
Amen.
Once you finish the music classes, you should try strumming the guitar a time or two. Once you graduate from tech school, you ought to maybe get a job. And once you've learned all these things about Jesus Christ and about the Bible, maybe you could join us in doing something with it. Now, if you want to learn but you don't want to apply, if you want knowledge but you don't want practice, eventually you're going to start saying things like, well, you know, that church has really changed and, you know, I just don't really agree with it. You agree with everything we teach. You agreed with it long enough to stay here and raise your family here. You just got to the place where you got tired of hearing about putting into practice what you learned when you didn't want to put it into practice. Right. It's the same reason lost people get sick and tired of you witnessing to that. Here you go. Every time we get together, you start into this Jesus stuff. Well, I only see you at Thanksgiving. And there's only one thing really worth talking about. With family members, I only see once a year. It's not like we're great buddies or anything.
Right. Yeah.
So there's an assumption made here that these Galatians who got saved are fools if they don't then live for their Savior.
Right. Yeah.
That somehow they have been bewitched if they aren't doing something with the Holy Spirit and the knowledge and the truth that God gave them. Someone has deceived them into thinking that Christianity is just pray a prayer, get saved, go to heaven when you die, and nothing in between. That's a deception. It's a false notion. It's a misunderstanding of Christianity. When somebody says, I think you ought to keep your religion in the church, they're professing an ignorance of our religion. Our religion can't be kept in the church. That would violate the principles of our religion. Well, I just think you ought to keep your beliefs to yourself. That would be a violation of our beliefs. You believe you ought to blow people up. We believe we ought to tell people about Jesus. If you're not blowing people up, you're not following your leader. If we don't tell people about salvation, we're not following our leader. So this isn't a Sunday morning church thing.
Amen.
It's a life.
Right.
It's a constant, ongoing, day-to-day, moment-by-moment life. Now, to be which means to move the nose back and forth rapidly. Maybe when you move your nose, does a bell ring? That woman need to go to a doctor, man. Anyway. See, Hollywood's made you think that witches are fun and pretty and cute and, you know, it'd be great if every family had one. Or they've convinced you, you know, they got long green noses and they all got a wart on the nose. I don't know why you have to, I guess you get that at witch college. You get a wart on your nose and they fly around on brooms and all that kind of stuff. No, it's none of that. In the Bible, it's none of that. To bewitch means to fascinate. To gain an ascendancy over one by charms or incantation. An operation which was formerly supposed to injure the person bewitched so that he lost his flesh or behaved in a strange, unaccountable manner, ignorant people being inclined to ascribe evil spirits to what they could not account for. So to bewitch means to charm or to fascinate, to please in such a degree as to take away the power of resistance. Now I ask you something. If you were ever interested in living steadfastly for Jesus Christ, and now you are not, what charmed you to the extent that you now are more interested in that than in Jesus Christ? That's what it means to bewitch. It doesn't mean somebody put a voodoo hex on your house and we need to come pour holy oil on your, you know, the mantel place and the doors and all that silly stuff. What it means is something stole your heart, your affection, your emotions, your dedication, your zeal, your desire away from Jesus. That's what it means to be bewitched. To fascinate. By what are you so fascinated that you gaze at that for hours while your Bible lays unopened?
Right.
It's witchcraft. Look over here. Watch. Stay. No, stay. But the Bible. No. Not the Bible. Watch me. Look at me. Text me. Face plant me. Level 34 me. It's time to eat. I don't want to eat. I want to finish this. It's time to go to bed. I don't need sleep. I want to finish this. Look, nobody threw chicken bones in your front yard and they spelled out 666. That's not witchcraft. That's not voodoo. To be bewitched means that you are fascinated by something other than Jesus Christ. You have looked with wonder. You have longed with desire. You have devoted your energy and your strength to something other than Jesus Christ. And for a lost person to do that makes perfect sense. But for a saved person to do that makes them a fool.
Amen.
Because a lost person has left one trash pile for another trash pile, one empty vanity for another empty vanity, but to leave the Lord of glory and the Savior of your soul for that is pretty incredible. Yesterday we had a yard sale, though we didn't sell the yard. But if you called it what it really was, I mean, who wants to come to a... We emptied out our closet and got rid of junk sale. So we had a yard sale. And if somebody came here yesterday and gave 25 cents for something worth 25 cents, reasonable. If somebody came and gave a dollar for something worth a dollar, reasonable. Some people gave $50 for something that was worth $75. Good deal for them. Helped. Okay, fine. But if somebody had driven up here yesterday in a $70,000 car and said, man, I really want that thing that might be an ashtray, it might be a vase, it might be the bottom of something that we lost the top to. How much you want for it? Well, it's 50 cents. I'll give you my car for it. You'd say something's really, really wrong with the thought process behind that transaction. That person obviously has no comprehension of the value of that car compared to the item they're about to walk home with. You would say, that guy's a fool. He traded a $60,000 car for a 50 cent ashtray. He's a fool. You wouldn't be just name calling. You would be defining. For somebody to give up a moment by moment, day to day relationship with the Savior of sinners, the friend of all mankind, the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star, the good shepherd, the Lord Jesus Christ, to trade a relationship with Him, to go back to a bar, or back to a crack house, or back to a movie house, or back to, come on! The Holy Spirit is just and right and within reasonable bounds to call you a fool for making that transaction. You obviously don't understand the worth and value of what you're giving up and you greatly overvalue what you're getting in return to the point, to the extent to which you can only be called a fool.
Right.
You're void of reason to trade a relationship with Jesus Christ for some junk pile out there in the world. Now the Bible says here, who, Galatians 3:1, who hath bewitched you? That's where the problem comes in. That's where the problem comes in. Somebody is exercising undue influence over these people at Galatia. They once abandoned Mosaic rite, ritual, and ceremony, realizing it could not get them any closer to God, could not get them any closer to heaven. For the Lord Jesus Christ, who is God and is eternal life and did give them a home in heaven, they understood that. And then somebody came in and persuaded them to go back to Moses and abandon Jesus. Who is your persuader? Who is the influential voice in your life? I try my best to read not just the Bible, but books written by men about the Christian life. I try to spend time with people, not just people who say they're saved, but people who really want to and are trying to live for the Lord. I try to come to church when the doors are open, not because it's required of me, but because this is where God's people are. And I'll tell you why. I have lived long enough to know that everyone is influenced by the voices of those with whom they spend the most time.
That's right.
I want to be influenced to go on and live for Jesus Christ. I'm certain I have a better chance of going on and living for Jesus Christ if the influential voices in my life are saying, go on and live for Jesus Christ. I have friends. I'm going to finish the sentence. I just gave you time to be amazed. I do. I have friends. Not all of them believe I should be as steadfast in my Christian life as I am. Not all of them believe that it is necessary for me to be as devoted to the Lord as I am. Not all of them believe that this measure of Christian dedication is necessary or reasonable. I am not going to give them opportunity to continually hammer away at me with their voice calling on me to water it down, compromise it, back away, don't be so hard-nosed, don't be so serious. Why? Because I know that we are all influenced by the voices to whom we give ear. I've seen saved people have a crisis in their life, turn completely and wholeheartedly to Jesus, and see the Lord work wonderfully in sparing the life of a child and putting their marriage back together, in healing a spouse, some circumstance of that nature. And in response, they are certain that no one is worthy of their life service and dedication other than Jesus Christ. And they will say, this has truly been a life-changing experience for me. I am sure that from this day forward, I am going to be a better Christian. Let me tell you how long that lasts. It lasts as long as the voices around you are influencing you to continue that way.
Amen.
If you begin to retreat back to the other voices that had you carnally compromised before that experience, you will soon find it was not a life-changing experience. It was a momentary spiritual high that could have been maintained if you had listened to people who were maintaining their own spiritual high. But as soon as you went back to the naysayers, and as soon as you went back to the compromisers, they watered you down once again, and now it's just like that thing never happened. Perhaps you finally worked up the courage one time to go on a mission trip, and you thought going on a mission trip had changed your life forever. No, here's what happened. For 7, 10, 14 days, the only voices in your life were voices that got up early to pray, that had morning devotions, that spent all day witnessing for Jesus, that came back in the evening and sang songs about Jesus, that went to bed at night praying, and you thought, I've had a life-changing experience. No, you didn't. You entered into normal Christianity, influenced by people who wanted to live for Jesus, and as long as those voices were influencing you, you were on a plane of experience that you thought impossible. And then you come back home and do what? Quit hanging out with those people, quit arranging your schedule to live for Jesus, fell right back into listening to all the junk you were listening to before, and found out it wasn't a life-changing experience. You had another life-changing experience after that one that changed you back into what you were before.
Right.
People have Sunday mornings when God moves on their heart and they come to an altar and fall on their knees and pray, God, I believe that. Help me. I want to do that in my life. And by 6 o'clock that evening, it's over.
Right.
They don't even get back for the evening service.
Preach.
Now, listen, I'm saying that for this reason. None of us is stronger than our flesh. None of us is stronger than the people we surround ourselves with. None of us is above being influenced by our surroundings. That's just a fact.
He says,
well, I'm an independent thinker and I do my own thing. And look, you can say all that you want, but you are more bold to speak up for Jesus in here then you are by yourself on your job, no matter who you are or where you are. You might force yourself to speak up for the Lord or yield to the Holy Spirit and speak up for the Lord, but you really got to work at that thing. You don't in the lobby here at church. Why? Because in both places, no matter what your personality, you are influenced by those around you and those to whom you listen. That's why God said, fellowship often, so much the more as you see the day approaching. That's why the Bible said they were daily in the temple fellowshipping in prayers and breaking of bread and teaching the word and so forth. Why? Why did Paul need to fellowship every day? Why did Peter need to fellowship every day? Why did John need to fellowship every day? These great apostolic men of the faith. Because they knew better. They knew they were, every day they got up could be a life-changing experience. It could be with a sermon. It could be with a gal on the job. Every day can be a life-changing experience. Don't allow yourself to be charmed.
Amen.
To be bewitched. To be enticed. Who would bewitch you? A false teacher? So I'd never join a cult. I'm not talking about that. A false teacher? I'd never become part of one of those kooky religions. No, a false teacher. A false teacher who says things like, well, you don't need to be that serious. That's false teaching. Well, I don't see why you have to just be some kind of a fanatic. That's false teaching. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy strength, with all thy mind. In all things that he should have the preeminence. Set your affection on things above, not on things in the air. For you're dead and your life is hid with Christ in God. Well, I just don't see why I'm getting all these Jesus, Jesus, Jesus all the time. That's false teaching.
Amen.
The fact that you don't see why it should be Jesus all the time doesn't mean the rest of us ought to close our eyes. Right. We see why. In him we live and move and have our being.
Amen.
All thy ways acknowledge him, and he should direct thy paths. Who? Who could bewitch you? Could be the love of money. Could be the love of money. I've married a wife. Bought me a cow. Must needs go plow with her. Or them, or however that thing's worded. Okay, so you got oxen. You got a plow. We understand that. You got to make a living. We understand that. You got a family. You got to tend to your family. You got to. We understand that. God has a family. God has work to do. He's got time fellowship with you. He's got more kids to spend time with than you do. He's got more work to take care of than you do. He's got time fellowship with you while he's getting his work done. You got time fellowship with God while you're getting your work done. He said, well, I just need to spend time with my family. Why is going to church with your family not spending time with your family? Why is eating a meal with your brothers and sisters in Christ and their families not spend time with your family?
Right.
Your family can do this together with a rod and reel. They could do this together with gospel tracts.
Amen.
Look, we all want to spend time with our families. We all do things with our families. You don't have to leave Jesus out. You don't have to have Jesus time over here and family time over here. You could let Jesus be part of the family.
Right. Amen.
Could be the love of money. It could be the former conversation. I must say this because it's true. It's true biblically, and it's proven true by everybody's experience. Your old flesh still likes what your old flesh liked.
Amen.
And if you get listening to the voices that your old flesh used to listen to, you'll find that your old flesh fit right back in a moment of time.
Yes, sir.
Wouldn't be hard at all. We had, now, it's just, I mean, everybody's got their thing they were part of growing up. But we had there's a box of records out there at the yard sale. You know, people who look through those records, you know what they're looking for? They are not looking for something new that they've never heard before. They're looking for something old that they used to like, that they forgot they liked, that they hadn't heard in a while, so they can get something they heard 500 times when they were young and hear it again. That's what they're looking for. Or they're looking for the one unknown secret album by their favorite singer that they forgot their favorite singer ever put out and they never really were able to find it before. And oh, there it is. That's what they're looking for. That's why we urge you to have gospel music in your house and gospel music in your car and gospel music for your kids. So when they're grown and they go back to what they liked when they were kids, it'll be something good, not something poisonous.
Amen.
That's why. That former conversation, it'll get you. You can go back to it anytime you want. You just got to stay around people reminding you you don't want to go back there.
Yeah. Amen.
Who? The greatest influence of all? Your flesh.
Yeah.
Your flesh. Well, you know, I'm just I'm tired of taking all this abuse and this criticism and yeah. We were singing that song this morning, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." And singing about doing battle with the devil. There's Martin Luther, man. The Roman Catholic Church and half of Europe is trying to kill that guy. And he's writing about one little word will fell the devil. I'm not backing down. I'm going on. And I'm up there thinking, we have no right to even read that song, much less sing it like we know what we're talking about. That guy's fighting the whole of Europe and they're trying to kill him. And I'm fighting my flesh that says, you don't want to go hand a piece of paper to a total stranger. They might say no or something. Yeah, I need a mighty fortress in my life for my great battles, don't I? Listen, my battle's with this guy. This flesh is trying to bewitch me.
Amen.
This flesh is trying to charm me. So Galatians 3:1 says this, O foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you that ye should not obey the truth? Before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth crucified among you. Now, next time, Lord willing, we'll talk about the difference between knowing the truth and obeying the truth. But it says, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth crucified among you. What evidence could the Galatians possibly have had of the crucifixion of Jesus Christ? They were not there when he died upon the cross, no more than you were there when he died upon the cross. They were not there when he took the nails in his hands and his feet. They were not there when the spear was thrust into his side. How could they, what evidence did they have of the crucifixion of Jesus Christ? Evidence that was among them. First of all, in verse number 2, received ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Their own salvation was evidence that someone had died for their sins and someone had risen from the dead with power. The fact that they had ever, if it was for a day, if it was for a week, the fact that they had ever been set free from their sin was evidence that a crucified, risen Christ was at work in their midst. Your own salvation ought to be proof enough to you, if you have salvation, of the power of God and what it can do. How it can immediately and just strip away all your fascination with and desire for the things of the world, the flesh and the devil, and leave you at least in that instant when you are saved, fascinated and adoring and desirous of the Lord Jesus Christ. Come on, if you got saved, I don't mean somebody conned you into saying something you didn't know what you were saying to somebody you didn't know you were saying it to. I don't mean you went to church when you were a kid for 10 or 15 years and you just tell everybody you're saved because you figure you must be. I went to church here all those years. I'm talking about when you really and truly were brought by the Holy Spirit of God to see the hopelessness and the vanity of every hope you ever held, and you trusted Jesus. And the moment you trusted Jesus Christ, He brought peace and joy and satisfaction to your heart. I don't know how long that lasted. I don't know how long it was before other influences and things began to eat away at that. But if you've ever been saved, you know by your own salvation, you have evidence that the crucified Christ lives. There's evidence in every real church of the crucified, risen Christ. As you look around and see men and women in love with each other who would have long ago gone their separate ways had Jesus Christ not moved in. As you see men and women with no decent training, no proper upbringing, loving their sons and loving their daughters and raising them up and training them up in the way they should go. What made this transformation? What broke this long-standing family tradition of worthlessness? And suddenly in the midst of a family of drunkards and drug addicts and abusers and idiots is this godly home. It's Jesus Christ.
Amen.
In the midst of every real church are men who, if they stood and told of their life of drunkenness and barroom fighting, you'd say, no way, not you. You never did anything like that. How can you not believe that man is what he was? Because the risen Christ has so made him into something else. That woman told of the depths to which sin had taken her, the shame which had been heaped upon her life following the ways of this world. As she told you with tears where she'd come from, you wouldn't believe it. You wouldn't believe that godly, holy, pure, decent, chaste woman could ever have been what she says she was. So what is that? That's evidence in your midst of the power and the glory and the grace and the mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ. And to let someone pull you away from Him, to let someone lure you back into that world of ruin and shame and heartache and disappointment, it's witchcraft. It's deception of the highest order. I understand how people with nothing could be bewitched by religious fakers, by political figures, by drug dealers, by gamblers. I understand that. If I had nothing, Bible says in Proverbs, to the hungry soul every bitter thing is sweet. I understand if I had nothing, anything would be better than what I had. But to have Jesus Christ, to have life and life more abundant, to have the Holy Spirit and the fruit thereof, to have joy and hope and peace and mercy and truth and eternal life, and give all that up for nothing? The Bible says you've got to either be a fool or bewitched. He's not just throwing words around to be insulting. He's using the exact and proper terms that describe the situation. Brother, after all Jesus has done for you, you'd be a fool to live for anything else.
Amen.
Sister, after all Jesus Christ has done for you, you'd have to be under some kind of a spell to walk away. And yet here it is, in the middle of a letter written to born-again people who have eternal life by the grace of God, without works, without the deeds of the law. Why is that even in there? Unless the Holy Spirit knew that every Christian who ever read this letter would need that warning. I need it. I need to be reminded to let the influences in my life be godly influences. To let the voices to which I listen be godly voices. I'm putting together a thing right now. I don't know if I'll see it through or finish it. See, it seems that my place in the body of Christ is often to say what nobody else wants to say. And so I'm preparing right now an open letter to missionaries, an open letter to pastors, an open letter to church members to address things that nobody wants to address. And there is a reason why the most dedicated, sincere people among us go to the mission field and why their failure rate is higher than any people in any line of work. The average missionary now spends less time on the field than he did on deputation to get there. Now you take a man so strong in his faith that he wants to go to the ends of the world to take the gospel. That's a good man. You take a man that is willing to ride around and live in a car and spare bedrooms and mission houses and for years, spend a fortune trying to raise enough money, just barely get by, and then take his family to the other side of the world. And a man that dedicated within 2 years is washed up and wiped out. I'm telling you why. The most dedicated, sold out, serious Christians among us need constant admonition and influence to do right and to stay right. And if the best of men get in a place where there's nobody there to urge them on, nobody there to preach to them, nobody there to remind them and to cheer them and to support them, they're going to wipe out just like they would anywhere else. These missionaries out there, they get out and just make a mess out of things and do good for nothing. No, they're good for plenty.
Amen.
But that which is born of the flesh is flesh.
Right.
And that which is born of the Spirit is Spirit. And I don't care who you are and how sold out you are. I don't care if you're here today and you're a deacon, a Bible school student, a founding member, a sold out, dedicated witness for Jesus Christ. If you go back to those old voices and back to those old friends and back to that old lazy, idle neglect of spiritual things, you can wipe out.
Amen.
That's right.
Just like anybody else. You used to go out on the street, now you don't. Who talked you out of it?
Right.
You used to go on visitation, now you don't. Who talked you out of it?
Amen.
You used to come to prayer meeting, now you don't. Who talked you out of it? Used to be you couldn't stand to miss church, now you can take it or leave it. Who talked you out of it? What are you listening to? I'm not still going because I'm a better Christian than people that quit.
Right.
I'm still going because I'm not going to listen to the people telling me to start coasting, start neglecting. I want to keep listening to people who are going to just keep putting that prod to me and say, go on, boy, go on, go on, go on, go on. The Bible in 1 Corinthians likens ministers to oxen. You know what you read about in your Bible? An ox goad. You know what oxen need? They need somebody behind them with a sharp pointed thing to hit them in their rear end and keep them moving the right direction. Preachers get to the place where they can't take an ox goad. Pretty soon it'll be good for nothing.
I'm the man of God. Don't you poke me with that verse.
You need it. You need it. You need preaching. You need encouragement. You need fellowship. Bible says in 1 Corinthians 10, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. You say, who's that? Him that thinketh he standeth.
Right. Yeah.
You say, well, yeah, but what kind of him that thinketh he standeth?
Yeah.
You doing okay this morning? Good. Make sure you're doing okay tomorrow. How? Hear the right influences. Avoid the wrong influences. Jesus Christ had been evidently set forth, and I like this, crucified among you. I hate to even start on this. I can't do it justice in a few minutes. Crucified among you. Wasn't Jesus crucified one time on the cross? But look at 2:20. I am crucified with Christ. 3:1, crucified among you. What's the proper mindset for the Christian? My life is over. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. My life is done. The choices aren't mine anymore. The decisions aren't mine anymore. The options aren't mine anymore. They all belong to the Lord. And what we need to see when we walk into the church house are men and women who have given up the lordship of their lives, who have given up the rights to the throne of their heart, living crucified lives for the crucified Christ. Why did He die? For others. Why did He rise again? For others. Why do we die to self? For others. Why do we live unto God? For others. Do you realize how many voices there are out there telling you, live for yourself? You realize how few voices there are telling you, lay down your life for others? Those are the voices I want speaking in my ears. I don't need that carnal crowd influencing me. I don't need that give up, it doesn't do any good crowd influencing me. Witchcraft doesn't come out once a year, Halloween night, then go back in the closet for the next set of decorations. It's an ongoing, constant thing. Whew. Be fascinated with this. Be charmed by this. Be delighted by this. Be excited about that. The Holy Spirit says, Jesus. Jesus. Be fascinated by Him. Be excited about Him. See, we're not against... Come on, let's lead in here. We're not against holiday parades. We care about them one way or the other. We're not excited about marching down a street. We're not excited about pulling a float that doesn't float down a street. We're not excited about twirling something or we're excited there's going to be a whole bunch of people in one place and we can go there and tell them about our wonderful Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Now you know what I'll see there this year? Just as you will. People who used to be excited about what we're excited about, who are now excited about something else, to the extent that they have now joined those who want you to stop doing what you're doing. They hadn't changed their doctrine. They haven't changed their core beliefs. They've just been bewitched into taking the side of fools. Now, if that could happen to people who were as dedicated to Jesus as we are, it can happen to us.
Right.
It's not said to be critical of those who have been drawn away. It's being said from Galatians 3 to warn us lest we... Come on. So I'd never... You're listening to me preach. They had the Apostle Paul. We're 2,000 years removed from the cross. They're within... Look, how many of you are 30 thereabouts? They're somewhere around 30. Andy, you don't even remember being around 30. I didn't say two 30s. 30. Look, think about it. In your lifetime, Jesus went to the cross and rose from the dead. Compared to the Galatians to Calvary. Your lifetime. That's nothing. And they could go back? You don't think you could go back? God help me.
Yes.
To be around you folks. To be in this book. Be listening to the kind of preaching that goads me, prods me to go on. Say, why? A lot of witchcraft out there.
Amen.
A lot of witchcraft out there. I don't want to be taken in. Amen. All right, let's pray. Father, help us this morning not to live, though saved, like fools. Father, help us this morning not to be indwelt by the Holy Spirit and yet under the influence of witchcraft. Please, Lord, please help us. Help us to continue to be influenced by those that would encourage us to do right and to please You. Please, Father, we ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.